everybody. Welcome to another episode of Tribe TV here on GIC. This month, we are going to be continuing our discussion on Reality Check, the American Corporation Part 2. As many of you remember, last month, prior to the election, we had covered many topics, including the Electoral College, the Strawman Theory, the two constitutions. And today, we want to expand that a little bit and bring it a little bit more up to date as far as where we are today with this entire American corporation. Many of us don't seem to, I don't know if many people are not aware or what, but they don't seem to understand that our liberties and our democracy has really been taken over by the corporate entity, and in more than one way, from lobbying to super PACs and many other very, very wealthy businessmen that are contributors to these concepts, have really taken away our direct link to creating change, either through our votes or through our elected representatives. So we're going to be covering this and much more in this hour here on Tribe TV. So without further ado, let me welcome my beautiful co-host from The Truth Denied, Miss Roxy Lopez. Hello, Roxy. Welcome back.
Thank you very much, Bernard. Thanks for having me on the show. I really appreciate it. I love doing these shows with you. And we have a little co-host here today, Santa Claus, for everybody that believes in Santa and believes in the United States of America as well. We have broken some myths on this show, and I think a lot of people are getting educated and checking out those source documents that you and I provided so that they could educate themselves on, you know, as you so eloquently just stated, where are we now? Where are we at in this country? And it's a very empowering information. So thanks for having me here. I really appreciate it.
I look forward to our monthly show together. And speaking of educating, I just want to share with everybody that you know, Roxy and I are not attorneys. We don't have Harvard law degrees or anything like that. So I find that I learn a lot when I do the research for these shows that we do together. I'm sure Roxy probably agrees. It's always like a learning experience. We grab a concept, and as Roxy says, we go down the rabbit hole with it. Right, Rox?
Absolutely. The best way to find out about anything, you know, think about it. If you're somebody who's looking for, you know, to purchase a couch, what do? You go online and you start researching the different fabrics, the different leathers, the different this, the different that, compared to, you know, new pricing, compared to something that's used in good condition. It's the same thing when we look into subject matters like this. It's the same exact thing. It's like, I think I'll take a look at how this all goes. And that's exactly what Bernard and I do. We go down the proverbial rabbit hole and we start to educate ourselves as well, or take off where we've left off, for instance, because Bernard, you're in Occupy and Roanoke, and you know, or Occupy Virginia, Occupy Roanoke. And as you know, you've learned a lot just by being a volunteer in Occupy. You start to get educated on what's really happening.
Yeah, especially when you're right there on the ground. Absolutely. So, Roxy, I know that you have. You probably have the organized person that you are, and I don't know how much organized we are today. You might have a little bit of a memory, or maybe a little bit of the outline from our last show. Can we kind of review a little bit besides? I know I want to remind everybody about the Electoral College, but maybe you can remind people about the straw man.
Yes.
Just really quick, and the two constitutions.
And of course, for anybody to reference this, we did a show. It is logged on to the Truth Denied website, which is thetruthdenied.com. Just look up the name of the show, and you'll find all the information. But yes, what we did cover were some people in the audience knew about some of these concepts, and some people were completely alarmed by it. And basically what it is there are two sets of constitutions that are unbeknownst to the United States citizens. And the one that we're more concerned with is the one that has been taking over for quite a few decades, which is the United States of America Corporation. And it is a separate entity from the United States of America government. And it is set up like a corporation. And basically, in a nutshell, we, the people, are part of that corporation. We are now entities of that corporation based on our Social Security number. And when we signed up for a Social Security card, etc., this is how they have been given the right to tax us. The Constitution states, and many people don't realize this, and it has never been amended, but the Constitution of the United States of America states that income, wages, are compensation for labor, therefore non-taxable. So you want to tell me why we're being taxed on labor? The only taxable income that we should be having is on a capital gain. So you see, they've operated like a corporation, and you and I and all of our people watching the show today, all of us, we are all part of that corporation. And there are different ways, which we didn't really get into, but there are different ways that have been proven in the past of how to get out of that corporation. And perhaps we'll cover it on another show, but one way is state citizenship, which sounds limiting, but really when you become a state citizen, you now revoke that corporate entity that you are, and you actually get back your inalienable rights. You revert back to your sovereign rights. And many people have done this, and it's quite astounding, because in the 80s, there were about 11,000 people in the country who had converted to state citizenship. Now there are over, I believe it's almost a million, and you can check those statistics, and you won't even believe this, but most of the people that are state citizens are foreigners, because they do their homework before they come here, and they become state citizens, and they are no longer part of the taxation system. They no longer have to revert to the laws, certain laws. For instance, driver's licenses. There's no law that says we have to have a driver's license, and there's no law that says that you are allowed to drive. It's a privilege. That's why the privilege gets taken away when you get 5 DUIs. You know what I mean? So what I'm saying is there are two different operations going on here, and the one that is really in control is the United States of America Corporation.
Right on, right on. And you know what? And actually, I do have a link that people can. Well, I don't have a link I can post on the screen right now, but if you haven't seen it yet, our friend Ben Stewart, who is the documentary filmmaker for Esoteric Agenda and Chymatica, his last movie, Ungrip, has a lot to do with that, about a gentleman who got himself removed from the roles, so to speak. And he did it. He said it was a long process, but he legally became a free person. He didn't need a driver's license. It's a really good, very good movie to watch if you're interested in looking up more about this. I had forgotten the movie the last time we talked, but I just looked it up, and I remembered that it's called Ungrip. And it's again, it's the same guy that did it's on Talismanic Idols, but he did Esoteric Agenda and Chymatica, two of my favorite movies. Ungrip I've only watched once or twice, but I need to go back and watch that again. One of the other things that we spoke of last time that I just want to cover ever so quickly is the Electoral College. And a lot of people talk about being disconnected from direct democracy. The Electoral College, I don't think people understand that when you vote, your vote does not count. Okay? I know you think it counts, but it does not count. The popular vote and the Electoral College vote are two completely different things. By law, these are actually, I'll read you the actual document here. The president and the vice president are not elected directly by the voters. Instead, they are elected indirectly by electors who are elected by popular vote on a state-to-state basis. Electors are apportioned to each state and the District of Columbia, but no territorial possessions of the United States. The number of electors in each state is equal to the number of members in Congress the state, each state is entitled. So what happens is the electors in the Electoral College are supposed to go with the state. Now, I know it's only happened once or twice in history where they don't vote the popular vote. But again, this to me is another obstacle for our direct democracy, or for our democracy. And I know everyone's like, oh, this is not a democracy, it's a republic. But it's supposed to be a representative republic. And to have electors who are not known to the public. Do you know who your Electoral College people are? Who's voting? I'm in Virginia. Who are my electors in Virginia? I've never seen them. I've never heard of them. They are never publicized. I don't know what their background is. I don't know what their influence or how they've been influenced. So this is something that we all need to take a very good look at and decide if this is the way that we want to continue going. And it gets worse. Wait till we get into lobbying and Citizens United, which we're going to do in just a moment. But so Roxy, what are your thoughts on that, and where are you with that?
Well, I think it's absolutely discouraging to find out that these representatives that we don't know, they, you know, the word representative alone. When you hear the word representative, my representative for my county or my state or my even neighborhood, whatever. Yeah. Representatives are supposed to represent the people's voice and the people's choice, and they're not, because they are being bought out and they are being paid to by the corporation. The corporation wants things to run a certain way, and they will pay to make sure that it runs a certain way. And one other little thing, not to throw us off course here, but what we are seeing systematically is the way in which the corporation runs is part of the New World Order agenda. See, corporations are taking over the world, and that is the whole Agenda 21. Yeah. Okay, which is a very real document. It is all about the corporations running the show. It is all about those who are in power, who have money, running the show. And there's a great deal of imbalance there. I mean, extremely imbalanced. So, with that in mind, this is all part of a bigger picture. And for those of you who don't realize, a lot of people keep saying the New World Order is coming, it's coming. No, it's not coming. It's here. Mm-hmm. We've been operating in that. I mean, just look at what WTO did. It ripped countries in shreds. That was, in the 90s, one of the big protests of that's the World Trade Order, getting all the countries to sign up, NATO, getting all the countries to sign up, the World Health Organization. I mean, we have to start looking at these entities and realize health, agriculture, government, it's all going into one world sort of manipulation. And it could be good if indeed the people's voices were representative. Mm-hmm. So back to what you were talking about with, right here in our own country, we have to eliminate, in my opinion, the Electoral College. We have to eliminate the tyranny that's going on. It is our job as citizens to police our government, not the other way around.
Oh yeah. And I can't help but think, and we're talking about now, here we are, the last show was before the election, here we are after the election. Many people decided they needed to keep Romney out, and of course Romney was not elected. However, for those people who still think that there is a choice, mm-hmm. and who believe that Obama really is the better choice, I beg you to please get on him and to start following start listening to the people. He is always, well, I mean, we're just going to keep explaining today, and you're going to realize that, and I know this is a cliche when it comes to like New World Order mentality or whatnot, that he's just a talking head. But we're going to explain why today, and especially for those of you who are very, what's the word I'm looking for, fluent in the language of like Occupy. You know, Citizens United is a very good example of why Obama wants corporations on his side. I mean, who is going to pay for the political ads if not the corporation? So wouldn't it, doesn't matter whether it be Obama or Romney or whatnot, wouldn't they want the corporations to have the support of the corporations to put all that money in to now that they have the right thing to Citizens United? So if you really think that it's about the people and the people have a voice, you know, we really have a long way to go to get that voice back. And it's not done yet. I think we still have a chance. I'm very optimistic by nature. However, I feel that it's getting close to the end. We're just going to lose it completely. We're going to move to complete tyranny. So this is why we do shows like this, to hopefully educate and motivate people to do more investigation and to get involved with creating the solution. We're going to talk about solutions before the end of the show, of course.
Absolutely. You know, I was going to say something. You know, people, don't be afraid to have the conversation with people you run across. A really good example. We had somebody come over, a company, a small business here in Casa Grande, Arizona, come over to do some work. The man was in his probably early 60s, and then he had his son with him who looked like he was about in his 30s. This is amazing. So he comes over to do this, you know, little work that we needed done, you know, half hour job, whatever. And how we got in the conversation, I'll never know. But the next thing you know, I and the father and the son are conversing about this.
Really?
And he, yes. And he said, you know, because he's a small businessman and small business people know the taxation. They know where it's gone south. They know that there's why we're struggling. They're very angry. But that's not my point. My point was we had an elaborate 20-minute conversation about the United States of America. And he flat out said, and this isn't a gun-toting, you know, tobacco-chewing, whiskey-drinking Arizonan. This is a normal, you know, just kind of, you know, normal guy like you and me, whatever normal means. But he said, we have to move to a revolution. We have to stop this. It's people in general are beginning to recognize, citizens of this country are beginning to recognize that we can't let this continue.
Absolutely. And, you know, it's, I'm so glad you mentioned that. I recently posted an article into the local Occupy group, and it basically said the same thing. That if we think that we're going to fix this broken system, it's never going to happen. They've got their grasp on it. We need to start thinking revolutionary beyond activism. And of course, I'm a nonviolent person. I'm a pacifist. But to me, revolutionary means turning my back on the system and creating a new one, unilaterally or horizontally. Kind of like the whole idea of that's why I love the General Assembly concept of Occupy.
Right.
It's people
well, we
coming
want,
together.
We want to restore, is what, don't you think? Don't we want to restore what works?
Absolutely.
You know, restoration. And see, that's the thing. We don't have to start all over. We can do a restoration, like an old building that the facade is all screwed up, and they come in and take the facade off and rebuild it just the way it was, except now it's stronger. It can handle rain. It can handle sun. It's the same thing. We want to restore a good idea. And I think initially our country had a good idea.
Oh,
I think our government had a good idea, a two-party system, et cetera. You know, don't get it. You know, and I need to mention this as well. You know, when the petitions went out to secede, and within 3 days of the election, 50 states had gone onto the White House website and signed petitions or executed petitions to secede. And I have to say, you know, right away, mainstream media was like, that's so funny. These people, they're so disgruntled because they didn't get their man. No, that's not what happened. In Arizona alone, 52% of registered Republicans didn't even vote. That's
mm-hmm.
how tired
yeah.
people are.
Yeah.
They get it, see? But I'm saying, I got to thank Ron Paul on this, because Ron Paul went out there and started telling the people, good for you, because it is the people who are the boss. And he reiterated and reinstilled and validated to the people, no, you're not stupid. What you're doing is the right thing to do. And
absolutely.
No one else... No one else on mainstream and no other candidates, no other congressmen and women, no one stood up for the people. And that is very telling.
Absolutely. And you know what? If anything, it's an act of rebellion and an act of protest. And it should be respected even just as an act of protest.
Well, it should. They should be listening to our voices. Absolutely. And it's unfortunate, Bernard, because, you know, it's like anything else. You can look at it, you know, I'll use my own example, you know, my husband and I. Sometimes if I'm too subtle about things, you know, it just goes right over my husband's head. And sometimes it takes like going to the, you know, the wall with something like, I said this before, I need this to happen. This needs to happen, hun. And then he goes, oh, I didn't realize it. Sometimes it takes us, you know, a little getting loud,
yeah,
and saying, you know, you're not listening to me because, and see, this is the thing, because they are part of the United States Corporation, they get paid for life. They go in for 4 years and they get a paycheck, people, for life. A good damn paycheck, okay? And that you and I pay for. That's robbing all of the other things. It's robbing the healthcare system. It's robbing our Social Security system. You name it. Now, this is where I get really passionate, because what I don't like is that you and I, as good citizens of this country, are paying and paving the way for these crooks. We have to stop.
Yeah. And we keep paying for the rest of their life, which is really...
The rest of their life, you know, and it's tyrannical. It's they're using us. They're abusing us. So the thing to do is, you know, sometimes we have to go, you know, like you said, you're not a gun-toting person and this and that and so forth. By the way, here's a statistic for you. In the state of Arizona, in the last few months... Guess what the number one sport is?
Hunting? Skeet?
Close. I don't know what you call it. Shooting guns.
Okay.
At the gun place.
The gun range.
Shooting.
Target shooting.
And all these businesses are opening up now.
Wow.
Doing gun range. So what is that telling you? And this gentleman that was here at the house a few days ago, he even said, you know, if you don't own a gun, he said, don't tell me. He goes, if you don't, you need to get a gun. I don't like guns. And he said, and there you can go. Now we've got one right here in the neighborhood. Like right in the neighborhood.
Yeah.
Or
range.
I can go for free.
Oh, wow.
And then I'll get a trainer and everything, you know.
Okay.
And even my husband, who isn't into guns, never been into guns. The other day, I mean, he doesn't even hear these conversations. And he came home one day and he said, we need to get a gun. And I was like, well, what made you say that? And he said he was at the grocery store and the guy in front of him, you know, he could see his guns and he's seeing it more and more and more. You know, people are exposing their guns more and more here.
Yeah.
So, anyway, my point being, and by the way, Washington State, where I come from, just passed a law that the concealed weapon, so you don't have to have a concealed weapons permit anymore. So, you see, the people are aware.
Right.
There are a lot of people who are aware of what's going on. Now we just have to educate the rest. And I think that you bringing into the picture, Bernard, the Citizens United, why don't we start with, can you... talk a little bit about overturning the amendments, Citizens United. What is Citizens United? Because
right.
I had a hard time understanding. I thought it was a group of people.
Right. And it's funny how a lot of people don't really understand what it means. They don't know why so many occupies are involved in overturning Citizens United. They don't understand the organization Move to Amend. But let me go back a little bit further with... with corporations. In the beginning, there were no corporations, right? There were people that were working, you were working, I was working, I opened the tomato farm, and I would sell tomatoes on the side of the road, and whatnot, and then there was corporate charters were put into play. And the corporate charter was a temporary incorporation for people, and it was basically created by the government for, let's say, to build railroads or, I guess, build highways or infrastructure or whatnot. But when the project was over, the corporation was dissolved. Okay, so where are we at with corporations now? Well, somehow, somewhere, I'm not sure of the date, and somebody please cross-reference this. I'm not exactly sure when it happened. I believe it was in the early 20th century. If I'm not mistaken, forgive me if I am, but a corporation was given infinite life. And by being given infinite life, the United States had to, you know, this is when shareholders started coming in, I guess the age of the robber baron, you know, the J.P. Morgans and the Rockefellers and whatnot. And when these corporations went public, they had one priority. And that one priority was to make money for their shareholders. And by law, if you look at today's laws on corporations, the number one priority for any corporation is to make money for their shareholder. The number one priority for any CEO of a corporation is to make money for their shareholder. I was just looking at a video. We have it on GIC, and we'll post it on the on the video description when we post this show on YouTube. However, they were talking this video. I love these people. I forgot what the name of the organization is. They do great videos, very informative. However, they were discussing how, you know, let's be very real about this whole green movement. Let's be very real about this whole philanthropic, you know, concept that these corporations, oh, you know, I remember before the BP oil spill, how everyone was like, not everyone, I take it back, but the campaign was Beyond Petroleum. I don't know if you remember that, how they were going to go green and this and that. And I remember my partner at the time was like, oh, well, I'm going to just use BP because at least they're green and they're trying to help the environment. And like, you know, a month later after this discussion, we have the BP oil spill in the Gulf. And, you know, and today we're still, you know, we're still dealing with the effects of that. So we have to realize that if a corporation is going green, they're not going to do it if it's going to interfere with their bottom line, with their dollars. The other thing that we have to take into consideration is that the role of government, now this is where Citizens United comes in and where it gets a little tricky. The role of government, and I don't get this whole concept, and you know, and I don't mean to offend anybody, but this Ayn Rand philosophy about me, and I come first, and how that applies into capitalism, and how capitalism should be a free market, it can do whatever it wants, and screw everybody else, and regulations are bad, and this and that. The role of government is intended to create regulations for the corporation and to protect the people from corporations going out of control. For example, coal mining waste, or nuclear waste, or manufacturing pollution or runoff or things like that. The government is supposed to be there to protect us and to regulate these people who are destroying our environment, who are overworking people. Don't forget, it was only about 100 years ago that child labor laws were put into place because companies got cheap labor and they worked kids, you know, 18 hours a day. So this was the role of government. And over time, what has happened is that the corporations got bigger and bigger and wealthier and wealthier. And it was in 2010 that they decided, you know, up until then, and don't get me wrong, they've always basically influenced all the elections. But before that, it was kind of done on the down low, for lack of a better term. Now they come right out into the light of day with Citizens United. And I don't want to go too much into the history. Oh, well, I do have time. Let me go a little bit into the history of Citizens United. It starts off as Citizens United versus the Federal Election Commission, FEC. I always wonder what FEC was. I learned that a couple weeks ago. It was a landmark case from the Supreme Court in which the court held that the First Amendment prohibited the government from restricting independent political expenditures by corporations and unions. In other words, because of the fact that the First Amendment says, you know, people have free speech, corporations did not have free speech because they're not people. Well, this particular amendment said, well, guess what? Now corporations are people. It's against the government to not allow corporations or unions, so it doesn't matter what side of the coin you're on, to spend money. I'm against unions spending money as well. I'm pro-union, but I'm not for unions influencing government. Absolutely not. I'm against any kind of corruption. So it doesn't matter what side of the coin you're looking at this. This is not a good thing. Allowing these corporations to put in billions or millions. I think it was 200 million in the 2010 midterm elections that they put into campaigns. Remember, we are supposed to be a democracy. We are supposed to be, whether we're a representative democracy, a republic, whatever your word of the day is, the reality of it is, it's supposed to be by the people, for the people. We are supposed to campaign for the people that we feel are good for us. And now, if we're, let's say I campaign for Gary Johnson, okay? Let's just say that. I campaign for Gary Johnson this last campaign. Do you think that me and all his supporters can match the money of Exxon or Goldman Sachs or Microsoft? Do you think it's fair that someone that is a grassroots candidate, and again, it doesn't matter if it's Gary Johnson or Jill Stein or Roseanne or whoever it is, that because they don't have corporate backing, not government backing, but corporate backing, to spend $200 million on campaign financing, who do you think people are going to listen to, especially those who sit in front of the TV all day long? Wink, wink. You know, we have to be very aware that this particular amendment is probably the most disastrous thing and has really opened up the floodgates for corporate takeover. And I'm sure we saw it here in Virginia when during this last campaign, I believe it was like $200 million was spent in just the state of Virginia on campaign advertising. Every even on Hulu or YouTube, all I got was campaign, 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 campaign. I would have loved to have had a Ford commercial, you know, but that's all we had. All we had was campaign advertising. So, Roxy, what is your feeling on this? I mean, did you get it? I mean, I know we talked about it before, so now that we have a better understanding, what's your immediate gut, your heart telling you about this?
What part? Because you said
well, just the fact that the Supreme Court has allowed corporations they've opened the floodgate.
I got the question. Okay, well, I think that it's the Supreme Court is part of the corporation.
Yeah,
you know, so it's loyalty is to the corporation, not to the people.
I agree.
So, you know, it's par for the course. I'm not surprised. I'm not shocked. And I, of course, you know, think that it's absolutely ridiculous. But at the same time, I love the idea of an advocacy group such as Citizens United. You know, it's very interesting. During the litigation, Citizens United had support from the United States Chamber of Commerce and support from the National Rifle Association. What does that tell you?
Right.
All right. So the good news is that there are groups and pockets of perhaps millions of people that are in the know who are struggling to defend the rights of our citizens. But we are, again, this is only more validation that I don't care if it's the Supreme Court justices. The system's been in place for so long with this corporation, and its duty and loyalty is to the corporation. So when you really think about it, it's pretty obvious that even our court system is unjust and it's run amok, and it's being paid to take care of the corporation. It's just the way it is. And if anybody has any thoughts about this, that okay, maybe this is the way the world is going, maybe this is the right thing, maybe the world is just evolving, we can't never go back, we can only move forward, that's a fine thought. Nevertheless, if we are going to join hands with our brothers and sisters across this world, the people, humanity, still need to police this planet. We still need to keep those who are too empowered or monopolizing our health, our food, our air, our water, and our housing, our essentials. We can't let them get into too much power, because all they will do is corrupt us. They'll corrupt you know, I mean, even citizens have been corrupted, you know, by, you know, somebody walking in from the government and saying, well, you know, why don't we do this? We'll relieve your $12,000 that you owe on your taxes. We'll look the other way if you do this. And so even citizens are bought out left and right occasionally just to shut them up. All I'm saying is that in order for this world to survive its next evolutionary trait, we've got to come into balance. There's nothing wrong with a new world order. There's nothing in keep this in concept, people. Don't send me emails saying that I'm like an alien being like you did last time.
In concept, not in practice.
Right. You know, people were saying they want to see my eyes closer up because now they're wondering if I'm a reptilian. It's like, keep it in context and stop getting silly. I've never minded the world coming together as one and functioning as one. I've never, ever been against that since I was a little kid.
Right.
I think this is my home. This is your home, the earth. So, you know, without getting all preachy on y'all, I'm saying I don't mind, and we shouldn't mind, that we can come together as humanity. The imbalance of power is what we're concerned with. So, no, this doesn't strike me as, oh my God, really? It's par for the course.
Absolutely. And one of the things I can't help but notice and to bring up now that you brought that particular thought up is that, you know, the whole idea of one international people, one international voice is something that I'm for. One government, that's where I might have a problem. I don't want one world government. I believe that while we should be able to reach, it should be a people-to-people thing, not a government-to-government thing. And if anything, it should not be run on the basis of profit. And that's where the whole idea of this, you know, New World Order comes. It's a new economic order. It's not a new order for humanity. It's a new order for corporations. It's a new order for money, for profit. And that is where I have a problem, because we cannot be a profit. Well, look what's happening to the planet. The more we, what's that word? The more progress we have, the less earth we have, it seems to be. Oh, let's tear down that forest for progress. You know, no, that's not progress.
Well, and that's where the checks and balances come in. You know, in all reality, you know, we are focusing on the reality and how each and every one of us feel about things. You know, money can motivate, fear can motivate. Sometimes fear gets your butt off the couch, you know, and getting back into, you know, where you're supposed to be in life or whatever. Depression, you know, maybe you're depressed and boom, something hits you and now you're back out there and, you know, your enzymes are going and I don't want to get into health matters, but you know what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm. You know, then you start running again and you start feeling better again because your endorphins are kicking in like they're supposed to, because your couch potato endorphins go to sleep with you, you know, all the rest of it. And so there's balance. And that's all we are really striving for, is that striking that balance in the world. And now we are a world because the internet is what has provided the communication now. And that's why you and I, we get to do shows like this and broadcast in 40 countries. We're so lucky because now we're meeting our brothers and sisters all over the world. And that's a groovy thing. But isn't it interesting that we now have a global revolution?
Yes, it's wonderful. It really is wonderful.
Right? Because everybody's waking everybody up and going, wait a minute, I don't like my country either, and I don't like my government either, and I don't like my, you know, these corporations that, you know, corporations own the wars.
Oh, well, and they fund them, of course.
They fund and own the wars and create the bombs and this. So the point is, we're going through, which is a good thing, we're going through an evolution. Okay, just like the industrial evolution or the technological evolution or whatever, the aeroplane evolution, we're going through an evolution and it's culminating really quickly. And we have an opportunity here. And this is where you come in, Bernard, and I come in, you know, the GIC and the Truth Denied and people like Miriam Delicato and all the rest. We're now educating people on where we're at, because everything did kind of speed up over the last 20 years, and we've all been kind of busy.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the economic cliff that we're hanging on and have been, and now we got another one in this country, right? If we educate ourselves during this process, I think we can bring things back to balance, but it's going to take some time. But if you don't know, people, if you don't know what's happened in the last 20 or 30 years, if you don't know the history, if you don't understand where you stand in all of this, you're not going to be able to propagate a truth or change your life for the better if you don't know what your choices are. And I think this is where these types of shows come in really handy, because our choices are here, but they're covered up with this mess. We, you know, citizens have forgotten what our choices and what our sovereign rights are.
And it's funny because even the fact, let's say, in civics class in high school, I think things have changed since, you know, we were in school, and I don't even know what they're teaching now as far as civics. I remember when I first started doing, I guess, these pundit-type videos and video shows, that I would ask people, what are the three branches of government? And nobody knew. I asked my friends, what are the three branches of government? I don't know. McDonald's, Kmart, and Walmart? I don't know.
Yeah. Because, actually, that's not a bad answer. Actually,
yeah, right? But the whole idea is that, even though, let's say, you know, we do learn civics and whatnot, where's the education on Citizens United, on lobbying, on special interest groups? Do you know that in, where was this? In 2008, 2009, they have found, the Center for Public Integrity found that more than 770 companies/corporations, and special interest groups hired 2,340 lobbyists to influence federal policies on climate change only. 2,340 lobbyists to influence policy on climate change only.
You're bringing up a really good point, because January 27th of 2010, Obama had condemned the decision during the 2010 State of the Union address, stating that the Supreme Court reversed a century of law, to open the floodgates for special interests, including foreign corporations, to spend without limit in elections. And
that's disgusting.
That's where we've, that's a very important part of what's happened.
Okay, so. Okay. Let's clear this up for everybody. What this means is that a company in China.
Right.
Can create a special interest group in the United States and put out commercials to make you vote for their candidate. And wait a second. Now, let's think about this. Why are they going to support a candidate? Because that candidate is going to influence the policy that they want to create. Not
for
your policy,
right,
not my,
whatever,
not for
yeah.
the people, for the corporation. So here we have a company in China can now spend $200 million on advertisements on television to get you to vote for, I don't know, Mitt Romney, who seems to have been the Wall Street candidate this time around. So is that right? Is that right?
See,
is that American?
Well,
and I don't even know if it happens in other countries. I don't know. I only know about this whole mess in the United States. Is it happening in other countries? We have a global audience. You let us know. Is something like this going on where you've lost the reins? I know in the EU, the European Union has basically taken over, making a lot of the independent country votes or their laws null and void, because it's an EU law. Now your law in Portugal doesn't count, you know, kind of like what they've done with the whole the Codex Alimentarius.
Right. Well, exactly. And that's another mouthful. I mean, we couldn't possibly cover all of this.
Yeah.
You know, what we're doing in this show, I think, Bernard, is we're just highlighting things, and people have got to do their homework.
Yeah.
But the bottom line here is, I think it's blatant, and I think it's arrogant that when they move to this level of decision making, they really are eliminating the population, you and I, who are the major contributors to taxation, to voting, We make lots of small contributions, but collectively our contributions are huge. And they're basically saying, you guys are worthless. Mm-hmm. We're just going to make these decisions. You know, we're going for, you know, show me the money. They're going to go where the money is. And now we're going into foreign entities. And I understand part of it because we are, you know, a lot of U.S. companies. I mean, just look at the car manufacturers. You know, some of it's built here, some of it's manufactured here, some of it's put together in China or Japan, then it's sent back here. We are becoming a global corporate network, okay? Again, let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater. It's not such a bad idea because, you know, it's also validating one more time that we are really becoming citizens of planet Earth. And I'll tell you why I like that, because that is part of our evolution outside the box, where we're not just born in a neighborhood, live 2 miles from where we were born in that hospital forever and ever and ever, really sheltered. We are becoming global citizens, okay?
Right.
Which means I think we're getting ready to meet our galactic friends, because once this is planet Earth home, not, you know, Roanoke, Virginia, you know, USA, right. Once we are planet Earth, then we can begin to meet our galactic friends out there, because now this is just a planet and a home for all. So I've always thought of that from when I was a kid. So a lot of this is growing pains for the planet, but it doesn't – let's not have, you know, the Lemuria Atlantean age repeat itself. History is starting to repeat itself. This is, I think, where we were in the Atlantean age, where we corrupted, where we, you know, we got into synthetic biology, we got into all of that. We're at the head of all of that with technology, with everything, robotic humans, all of it. So it's not a bad thing. The reason why we destroyed it the last time is because it got all out of whack. So it's okay that we want to be neighbors with all of our countries and friends. A global family. That's a good way to put it. Perfect way to put it. But let's not forget that along the way, and this is just part of the process. And so there's nothing to feel bad about, is what I'm saying, that we want to overturn certain things and we want to get rid of some of the executive orders that have been tacked on overnight, literally, to the NDAA, to overthrow and fire people in our government, or, you know, restore our original, something that worked much better for we the people. It's going to be up to us, because I'm telling you, if you were getting their paychecks, you wouldn't want to.
Oh, of course. They're going to fight tooth and nail.
They're going to, because that's their paycheck. That's their car. That's their house. That's their zip code. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's going to be up to we the people. And it is a good thing. It is not a bad thing. Yes, we're rocking the boat. And let me tell you something. We're rocking the boat because the boat's got major holes. And either we're going to sink with the boat, or we're going to rock that boat, pull it out of the water, fix all the holes, make it bigger and better than badder than ever. And put it back in the water.
All right, right on, right on. Thank you, Roxy. I just wanted to...
vote for me!
We got to vote for Roxy now, okay? That'll be the... Well, you know, that's a very good... You know, and that takes us toward our last few minutes. We got about 10, 15 minutes left here about creating solution. And one of them is running for office.
Yes.
I'm seeing a lot of young people that are now talking about running for city commission. I have a friend of mine... that is going to be running for city commission here in Roanoke. Last time we had an occupier running for city commission. He didn't win, but at least he tried. As well, it's also about getting involved in your local government. I know you're very much involved in your local government. I'm involved through Occupy Roanoke. For those of you that don't know about Occupy Roanoke, we are a affiliate for Move to Amend, and I'm going to tell you more about Move to Amend in just a minute, and that's a great way that you could get involved. Well, actually, let me just go into it a little bit. The best way for us to really start taking the power back, okay, now that the Supreme Court has made it official that, you know, Citizens United won, and that, you know, these special interest groups, these lobbying groups now are people, we need to create another constitutional amendment. And yeah, that's really hard. It's going to be a struggle. I think it took Citizens United 10 years almost. Almost, maybe about 7 years, I believe, when the Citizens United thing started. It took about 7 years for them to get to the Supreme Court, and they won, and unfortunately, maybe they didn't realize the fallout, but now anybody, everybody, any country can now influence our elections. So the best thing to do is we need to work toward changing that and overturning it and creating another constitutional amendment where corporations are no longer people. And one way of doing that is there's many organizations out there. There's one particular organization that we are affiliated with. As a matter of fact, like I said, we are, the local representative for this organization called Move to Amend. And let me double check, it's movetoamend.org. Let me see if I can type that into the chat for you guys. movetoamend.org. I didn't put the HTTP, but you can copy and paste it. Oh, it's asking me to log into my own show. Okay. anyway, Move to Amend. They've got a wonderful amendment already prepared. A lot of us are working on a local level to have our local cities, counties, and state to overturn the Supreme Court decision. And I believe there is a county here in Virginia that has already done that. And here in Roanoke, we are going to try to do the same thing through Occupy Roanoke and through our friends and the community. We want our city, the city of Roanoke, Virginia, to also to overturn that. You can do that. All you have to do is find out your city commission meeting, what time you have to be there, get a group of people, get on the agenda, and bring a proposal. And I believe movetoamend.org does have one already written up that you can take. And you can also, you know, edit it to whatever works for you. But again, it's about getting on the ground and changing things. You know, I read a quote the other day from Howard Zinn. And he said, Howard Zinn's gone, if I'm not mistaken. I think he passed away, yeah. But he said something about, you know, voting and elections might help a little, but not enough. You need to get on the ground and fight for what you need to do. Elections aren't going to change anything. We, the people, need to get our feet on the ground and go out and fight for our liberties. And that means getting involved in your local government. That means getting involved in your local Occupy or your local special interest group. Or here I live in, since I'm in Virginia, there's a lot of people that are against Monsanto. I live in Western Virginia, so there's a lot of farmland. People want to, you know, they want to overturn the ability of Monsanto having patents on seeds. So people are out there trying to do that. It's all about participating, you know.
Yes.
What's that saying? Democracy is not a spectator sport.
Right.
You know. And so what are some of the things going on in Arizona? Or what are some things that you could perhaps share with us, Roxy, as far as participating and creating solutions.
I think that anything that anyone wants to do, anything, is a step in the right direction as far as if it's downloading flyers, sending mm-hmm. them to your email list, putting them in mailboxes. I don't know if that's legal. Putting them on cars is. But there are so many things that an individual can do. Without having to do an exchange with a congressman or a congresswoman or a city council member, etc. And I have to agree, so thanks for saying that, but I've got to say this. After the elections, this was amazing. When Obama won, there were teenagers still in high school, hundreds of them at our Capitol, demanding to see the other 500,000 votes that hadn't been counted. And they would not leave. And that was huge, because you mentioned earlier today in the show that what are they teaching kids in school? What are they teaching kids in school? Because these kids knew what was right and knew what was wrong.
Very cool.
And this was so awesome to see. And the inspiration that kids are having now of wanting to get involved in government or wanting to get involved in change and so forth. So this is really, really inspiring to me, because I wasn't sure if kids even knew what was happening. So this is and support those kids. You know, that's what I say locally. Support your kids. If you don't want GMOs, go to our website, thetruthdenied.com. We have the full-blown methodology information, source documents that you can just download and take right into your city council leaders, or any leader for that matter. And let's remember something. We have the power, and knowledge is power. Once you have that knowledge, and more and more and more of us, I was also asked to run in District 1 for Congress in Arizona, and I didn't. But maybe now that I have time, and there are a lot of people like Steve Sussman who ran, and he didn't win, but he's going to run again. He's going to keep running. So I have an opportunity to try again and try again. And I think the more that we get the non-career politician running, there'll be more of us than them, and I think that's the idea. In other words, don't go future tripping on this, people. Just do what you can do right now. Mm-hmm. And what you can do right now is A, educate yourself, and B, pick a lane. You know, and I'm not trying to be facetious. Pick a lane. Pick a subject matter that you enjoy doing research on, or that you enjoy collecting, and start a fire somewhere. And yeah. I mean a proverbial fire. Start a fire. Start writing letters. Start sending them in. You know, take 10 minutes a day, 20 minutes a night when you get home from work. Create the time. It's there for us to do. And it's really just about the masses getting involved in this. And the more and more and more that you and I get involved in this, the there'll be more of us than there are then. There's 300 million people in this country, and there are 7 billion people in the world. We're a powerful majority. Use it.
Absolutely. I need to make a...
I can't hear you.
It would help if I turn on my mic, right?
Okay. and one other thing real quick, and then please, you need to make a bunch of announcements.
Mm-hmm.
I want to say, as David Carey said in wrapping up what Bernard and I have just talked about today, money isn't speech, and corporations aren't people.
Absolutely.
Just remember that.
And you know what? There is a stamp, a money stamp that we have at Occupy that says that. We stamp all of our money with that. So when people get the bills, it says that very same thing.
Oh, and I want one.
You can get one at movetoamend.org. You can get one at movetoamend.org. They're like 10 bucks or 5 bucks. Anyway, I just want to clarify... when we were talking about Citizens United, the Citizens United opened the floodgates to special interest groups to give out, you know, to put money into campaigns anonymously. However, corporate personhood, where corporations were seen as people by the U.S., has been 126 years. That was a long time ago. 126 years ago, in 1886, the Supreme Court declared that under the law, corporations were persons and gave them the same rights as human beings. We need to change that.
Yes, we do.
We need to change that. It's long enough. 126 years is long enough.
That is true. That is correct. Amen. Right on. So let's talk about the GIC. You've got a lot of stuff coming up. You've got a busy month. And let's let everybody know as well, we will not be doing a Tribe TV for the month of December. Bernard and I have decided to take it off.
Yeah, it's the last week of the year. It's Christmas week, New Year's week. So we decided we're just going to take time to be with our friends and our family and rest in between the two holidays, because it would have fallen on the 27th. So we've decided we're going to go ahead and skip next month. However, next month, the GIC does have two webcasts anyway, and one of them is with Roxy, so we're very happy. What's the other one? I thought I had two. Yes, we do have two.
You've got to tell them all about that one on the 15th.
I will. Let's talk about the 15th. Here on GIC TV, we are having on December 15th, we're doing a very special two-hour end-of-the-year love-a-thon. And it's going to be hosted by our dear friend Roxy Lopez, and we're going to be joined by a stand-up comedian and star of Last Comic Standing, Terry Joyce. She is also known as the Hollywood Hemptress, and she is also a host on Normal TV's, she has a TV show on Normal TV. She is great. She's a great friend of ours. She's been a friend of the GIC for years. I've been on her show several times, and she does really good comedy. So she's going to be doing a a cannabis comedy routine, and then she'll be joining Roxy for some discussion as well. To highlight the show, we have Anelia Benz coming back. We love Anelia. Anelia, again, has been a member of GIC for years and a very dear friend of mine for quite a while. I love her dearly. I love her message. She has so much to offer this planet and humanity, and we're so grateful that she's going to be joining us as well. I'll be coming on to do, a little talk about the end of the year and what's going on with the world, with us, with the movement. And we're calling it a love-a-thon because we are blessed, actually. It is a blessing that we as the GIC, we function as a gift economy, and we do rely on your donations. So we're going to, instead of making it a telethon or a cash bomb or money bomb, we want to give you some entertainment. We want to give you some food for thought, and we want to bring some of your favorite people around and hopefully inspire you to help us maintain for the next year. It is the end of 2012. We'll be collecting for 2013. Again, it's a love-a-thon, and I'm very, very grateful that we have the great people, Roxy, Terry, Joyce, and Anelia Benz joining us. As well, we'll have a lot of other people will be in the background. Yvonne Weiss will be in the background collecting the money and letting us know what's going on. Of course,
she's going to be monitoring the money.
She'll be monitoring the donations. And
she's
letting
our treasurer.
Us know. She'll be the treasurer for the show. So we're very grateful. We love Yvonne. Also, on the solstice, this is another GIC TV program. We're going to be doing live here, and actually this is the first real announcement I'm doing. So if you're watching this, I want you to think about here we are. It's the end of the Mayan calendar or whatever, the end of the cycle.
The beginning of the new one.
The beginning of the new golden age.
Yes.
What intentions do you want to bring in to this? It will be the beginning of the age of Aquarius, officially. It will be the beginning of the new Mayan calendar. It'll be the new beginning of the astrological, the way the solar system goes around, you know, from all the signs and whatnot, which is why we're ending up in Aquarius. What do you want to bring into that? And what we're going to be doing here on 12/21 is we're going to be doing a live intention circle. And what I'd like you to do, and I'm going to be setting up a page, is I want you to send me your intentions. That way we can do them live here on GIC TV, and we'll read them out loud. We'll all meditate on them together at the same time. It's a much more powerful way to do meditations and sending intentions out into the universe. So I look forward to hearing from you guys. And again, I'll probably post that link here on this video. And, let's see, GIC Radio, we got a lot of great, fantastic shows coming up. As usual, we have great guests. What can I say? We've got great guests. Oh, I do have an announcement, though. The book, Faces Behind the Pages That Inspire, was supposed to be released on 12/12/12. I've just been notified that date's been pushed forward again. For publicity purposes, it's being pushed forward. So maybe it'll be 1/1/13. I don't know. So I did put out that it was going to be out 12/12/12. It's not going to be put out on 12/12/12. It'll be a little bit later. And then, of course, don't forget next year, our dear friends, Collective Evolution's new movie, The Shift, is coming out. I'm in it. Miriam Delicato's in it. Anelia Benz is in it. Luke Rakowski is in it. So it's going to be a really, really great, great documentary. So make sure to go ahead and check that out in the early part of next year. And what's up with you, Roxy? Tell us a little bit about your month ahead.
I'm going to be hanging out with you.
Well, besides that.
We've got, you know, every Tuesday night, of course, we have our shows. We've got a couple of really wingdingers to wrap up the year with. And, of course, I'll be on a couple of yours as well. And I really look forward to that. And I'm really, I've got someone's interviewing me this Saturday, Chris Vortex. On Revolution Radio, we're going to be talking about Morgellons disease and chemtrails, and there's going to be quite a few people on that show, and they've asked me to, you know, sort of co-host it. So that'll be this Saturday, nice. And I spaced out what time that show is. I can't remember. I'll get it for you in a minute.
I get it all the time.
And then we've got Howard Stein's coming back because he's the one that's put all the information together, and he's been a prepper, and he's taking his family off, believe, on the 18th, and so we're going to get a report from him. They're leaving Washington State, and they're going to be going off to Nevada with all their stuff, their kitties, their dogs, their kids, and because he doesn't put it past the government to do a false flag on December 21st, and he just doesn't want to be home, and we'll see how that goes, and so we're going to be on the road with Howard. And I think it's just exciting, you know. And then we're going to have Dr. Lori on next Tuesday, and the head producer director of the Discovery Channel and the History 2 channel. So they're both going to be on the show, and this is going to be mind-blowing. This gentleman, Jack Smith, has over, I think about 30 documentaries, and they're all huge, huge. Mm-hmm. And I think our discussion is going to be the Superstorm documentary that was released on the Discovery Channel. So that'll be it. And then, of course, our last show of the month would have been on the 25th, but I have a date on the 25th, so I'm not going to be able to do a show that day. And I hope you understand that. And I don't know who's going to be in the place of my show, if they're just going to do another show, you know, one of my older shows or whatever. But we're going to take that date off. And then, aren't I doing a show, Turnabout? When are we doing Turnabout?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you for reminding me. And being that this is our Christmas card to you guys, so right now, let us just say from Tribe TV, happy holidays. And
yes.
Roxy and I will be back together on the radio, together. Her and I and Yvonne and Trevor will be interviewing each other. We do it every year. It's a tradition on GIC Radio, January 7th. And that's basically where we all sit in the interviewer chair. So we all take turns interviewing.
It's so much fun.
We call it the Turnabout Show. So it's a lot of fun, and I hope you guys will check it out. That'll be January 7th on GIC Radio.
Absolutely. So I think we're pretty busy, and I think it's a lot of fun. And I think for the most part, Bernard, you always make it so easy to do these shows. So I really, really appreciate it. I'm sure our audience appreciate it. And I just want to give a big, big mahalo and aloha to all of our listeners, all of our watchers, both for the Truth Tonight and the GIC and the collective groups, because without you, we would have no shows. We'd have like one listener. You know what I mean? It'd be like, oh gosh, we only have one listener today. It's amazing.
I have a little body here for the end of the show.
I'm loving it. What's that?
We have a little buddy here on the end of the show. I'm sorry you can't see. I'll let you see what we
got. I can't see your buddy.
Sophia's here. She just jumped on the desk. Good timing,
Sophia. Oh, hi, Sophia. you know what I mean? So, you know, blessings to everybody, and thanks for being a part of this, because this isn't about, you know, me or Bernard. It's about all of us. And so I just want to say thank you for all of your support, all of your prayers, all of your wonderful emails, your posts, your sharing all of the work that Bernard and I do. I just want to say thank you. It's been a fast and frivolous, you know, this year just flew.
Fast and furious.
I was not
frivolous.
I was going to say fast and furious, and then frivolous was starting to come out. It doesn't matter. It was fast.
Yeah. It really has been.
So, you know, peace to you, and thank you. And we want to continue doing our work, and I see nothing stopping us.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
I appreciate that.
And again, to wrap it up, thank you guys very much. I'm here with Roxy Lopez. My name is Bernard Alvarez, and I am from thegsc.org, and of course, Roxy Lopez is from thetruthdenied.com, and you can find her on Revolution Radio, and you can find me on GIC Radio every week. And again, we are very blessed to continue doing the work that we do, thanks to your contribution. So thank you very much. Have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year from Tribe TV. Bye-bye.